In this video, we'll discuss about mandibular fractures classification. Generally, when an essay question is asked from the mandibular fractures, they will first ask to write about the classification of the mandibular fractures. So, there are many classifications of mandibular fractures, but these three classifications are very much important and you have to write in the exam. Okay? So, the first classification is Kruger's general classification. After that, Dingman and Natwick's anatomical classification and direction of fracture line. Okay, so these three classifications. First, coming to the Kruger's general classification, in that there are seven categories of fractures. First one is simple or closed fracture. That means the fracture which is not exposed to the external environment. It may be through the intraoral or maybe the external environment, that is outside the oral cavity. Generally, fractures of the mandibular condyle are simple or closed one, right? Then coming to the compound and open fracture, very much simple. If you understand little bit, you can write it. Compound and open fracture, okay? That means they are opposite to the simple or closed fractures. They are communicating with the intraoral cavity or maybe through the or external environment. Okay, then coming to the comminuted fractures, that means one subunit of the mandible is divided into the multiple pieces because of the multiple fracture lines. Okay, that means if the mandibular body region, if you take, there are more than two fracture lines within the body, then it is called as comminuted fracture. Then coming to the complex or complicated fractures, that means fractures associated with the adjacent injuries to the adjacent nerves or any joints or muscles like that. Okay, important vital structure injuries along with the bone fracture, then it is called as complex or complicated fracture. Then impacted fracture means after fracture bone segments override with each other. That means one segment of the bone may be locked against the other segment, that is called as impacted fractures. Then Grinstead fractures, that is incomplete fractures. That means only one cortical plate is fractured and another cortical plate is bent. This type of cases generally seen in the children and in the condylar neck fractures. Then coming to the pathological fractures, that means mandible weakened due to the cystic tumors or anything other. Okay, maybe due to the residual resorption, in that case that is called as atrophic fracture, but due to the cystic tumors it is called as pathological fractures. Okay, so under Kruger's general classification we have seven categories. If you remember and write these seven categories, that is enough. In some textbook they are given many varieties under Kruger's general classification, but that is not correct. If you write these seven things, that is enough. Then coming to the Dingman and Natwick's anatomical classification, that is he divided mandible into some subunits, into subregions. Okay, accordingly, so mandibular symphysis fractures, you can see here, symphysis fracture, mandibular symphysis is nothing but the midline area, that is fractures running through the in between area of the mandibular central incisors. You can see in this diagram, this is the symphysis region, that is fractures running through the two central incisors, that is called as symphysis fractures. Then coming to the parasymphysis fracture, parasymphysis is a region bounded between two vertical lines distal to the canine. Okay, so in this diagram you can see that this is the canine, this is the line passing at the distal aspect of the canine. So in between these two vertical lines, that is called as parasymphysis fracture. Okay, after that, mandibular body fracture. Mandibular body is the region distal to this vertical line, okay, and anterior aspect of the, up to the anterior border of the masseter muscle. You have the masseter muscle like this, okay. This is the masseter muscle, okay. So mandibular body is the region from this vertical line on the canine to the anterior border of the ramus. This complete area is called as mandibular body. Okay, after that, mandibular angle. Mandibular angle is bounded anteriorly by the anterior border of ramus, okay, anterior border of masseter muscle, like this border, and posteriorly it extends from the third molar to the posterior superior aspect of the masseter muscle attachment. That means this is the posterior and superior attachment of the masseter muscle. Okay, so anteriorly this is the line and posteriorly like this. Okay, so this area is called as mandibular angle. Okay, so masseter muscle attachment, it is attached in the mandibular angle region and it has some attachments in the mandibular ramus region also. But mandibular angle region is from the anterior border of masseter to the a line extending from the third molar to the posterior superior aspect of the masseter muscle. Okay, after that, mandibular ramus is extended from the posterior border of angle to the two lines connecting with its apex at the sigmoid notch, like that means like this. Okay, this is the sigmoid notch. So apex of the two lines is at the sigmoid notch. This is one line and this is another line with the apex at the sigmoid notch. So this area is called as mandibular ramus. After that, you know that this is the mandibular condyle and this is the cornoid process. So in which area fracture is running, accordingly it is classified. This is the most commonly used classification of the mandibular fractures. You have to and you must have to write this classification. Accordingly, one half side of the mandible is divided into symphysis, parasymphysis, body, angle, ramus, okay, and condylar, coronoid, and after that dento-alveolar fractures. That means fractures involving the alveolar process of the mandible without extension to the basal bone. That means if the fracture runs like this, that means it is involving the alveolar bone in the region of second premolar, first molar and second molar, then it is called as dento-alveolar fracture. Fracture is not running to the lower border of the mandible. It will not involve lower border of the mandible. It will involve only alveolar process. Then it is called as dento-alveolar fracture. Okay, very much simple to understand and to memorize also. If you if you write like this and draw a diagram like this, then it is enough. Okay, after that, based on the direction of fracture and favorability for treatment, this classification is especially for angle fractures. Okay, then accordingly it is divided into horizontally favorable, horizontally unfavorable, vertically favorable and vertically unfavorable. Regarding this fracture classification, we'll discuss in detail about this classification in mandibular angle fractures. Okay, for essay questions, to write the mandibular fracture classification, you have to write three classifications. Okay, and draw this diagram, that is enough. There is no need to read or no need to write extra classifications at the undergraduate level, because you have to look after your time also. When you are writing the exam, you have to complete one essay question within 30 minutes. So you can't write so many classifications. But these three are the main important classification, and if the mandibular condylar fractures is asked, then you have to write about the Lindahl's classification also. Okay, so if you like this video, hit the like button, share the video, subscribe the channel.